Dear Dinesh Bhai, Vice President Ramon, Mayur, seniors, fellow members, ladies and gentlemen, very good evening and warm welcome to you all. Friends, tax structuring is an age-old tug of war. You know, in I think almost 75-80 years ago, we had in 1936 the decision of Duke of Westminster was pronounced, and in that decision, the House of Lords, you know, laid down a cardinal principle that every man is entitled, if he can, to order his affairs so that the tax attaching the appropriate under the appropriate acts is less than what it otherwise would be. So this particular principles came under certain clouds. You know, there were decisions of Ramsay in UK, followed by MacDowell's principle, and there was a shadow cast on this cardinal principle. And subsequently, there were decisions, including Azadi Bachao and Vodafone, where these shadows have been to a great extent cleared. However, what has happened is globalization as a driver has been you know, changing the contours of you know, doing business globally, and that has been also you know, making the structuring that much more complex. Businesses are getting spread all over the world, and that is actually driving the whole you know, tax structuring exercise becoming more complex. With that also, what has happened is the 2008 economic crisis resulted in the countries realizing that their tax revenues were affected, and that has led to you know, initiative pushed by G20 and taken further by the OECD countries, which is known as base erosion and profit shifting, so BEPS initiative. And at every G20 meeting, the you know, finance ministers underline. In fact, at the meeting in 2014 in Sydney, they reiterated the country's commitment for a global response to the BAPS. And this is also arisen from the fact that national laws have not kept pace with the global corporations. The capital has become that much more fluid. You know, it can shift from one country to the other within fraction of a time. And also the digital economy, which makes doing business practically from anywhere in the world. So this has left to gaps which have been exploited in their perception by the multinational companies. And the BAPS has detailed a list of 15 action items, and we'll get to know more about that. But this, you know, most countries have been suffering in terms of their public finances have worsened, and this has led to a flurry of activities in this area. And as a result, what I perceive is that the tug of war between the taxmen and, you know, taxpayers and tax professionals on the other side will remain, will continue, and you know, navigating through the newer maze of tax regulations will be the order of the day, and this complexity levels will continue to increase. In the background of this, we today have Shri Dinesh Bhai Kanabar, who is a very well-known name. I don't need to introduce Dinesh Bhai to the audience of Bombay Chartered Accountant Society. With over three decades of experience, he will share with us his practical experiences and guide us through this you know, very interesting subject of tax structuring recent developments. Dinesh Bhai has been a prolific speaker and contributor at various forums. He's been a member at various committees, and with over three decades of experience, we all look forward to hear him. Before I invite Dinesh Bhai to address us, I request Raman, Vice President, to offer a memento as a token of our appreciation and gratitude. Dinesh.
Nitin, Mayur, Raman, seniors in the profession, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, let me begin thanking Nitin for inviting me for this meeting today. It's been a long, long time since I spoke at the BCA forum. And when Mayur and Nitin were talking to me, I was only hoping that certain things didn't develop at the last moment where I were to excuse myself, and I'm really feeling good that I'm here before all of you talking to you about a subject which I think is a very interesting subject. As Nitin mentioned, when you speak of tax structuring, we are all aware that you'd all like to structure our operations in a manner that gives rise to minimum tax. And as things have developed, whether it is in India, whether overseas, we have seen how the revenue would like to go behind these structures and want to see that they are able to collect maximum tax. So what I will try and do over the next maybe about 1 hour or so is to talk to you about some of the recent developments that have taken place in the field of tax structuring. What is one seeing as the attitude of the officials in India? What is it that one is seeing globally? Are there some takeaways? And more particularly, as Nitin mentioned, BEPS is probably providing a different impetus, and the way we used to approach tax structuring in the past and the way we will be approaching it going forward probably will be very materially different. So with that, let me just begin with a few thoughts. You know, we talk about the economic scenario, what Nitin spoke about, how as a result of the fact that the revenues of most of the countries are shrinking, the approach to tax structuring has changed. We'll talk about some thoughts on inbound structuring, outbound investment structuring. We'll then talk about BEPS and then take an overview of what are the takeaways. So let's first begin with the Indian scenario. And all of us understand this. I don't intend to make this a macroeconomic discussion. We are aware that over the last few months, we have seen a resurgence in the economy. We are seeing a situation where there is an expectation that the economy will improve, grow at a much higher pace, more foreign investments will come in. If I may mention what I have heard jocularly somebody say, is that for a long, long time we are seeing a trailer, and the trailer proposes to be a great magnum opus. We are now waiting for the movie to start and say that yes, this magnum opus is indeed worth watching. So hopefully the next budget which comes will be providing that impetus which we are hoping to see, and the economy opening up, liberalizing, more investments taking place. But within all of this are several things which are arising. So for example, we for the first time have a situation where the budgetary deficit is likely to be bridged, not because of some of the good things that we have done to the economy, but because of the falling oil prices. And I was talking to one of the participants earlier on that for the first time we are hearing globally a proposition that countries in the Middle East, which have traditionally for decades been tax exempt, are now looking at taxation as a means of raising revenues, because the revenues from oil are sort of drying up. And therefore the question is, will we over the next few years see introduction initially of indirect taxes and then of direct taxes in countries like UAE, Oman already has a tax regime, and some of the other countries in the Middle East. But again, a very, very interesting development. But what one is also seeing here is that tax litigation in India is becoming very, very expensive proposition, very, very uncertain proposition. And I think I would just like to talk a little bit about it, because any structuring that you do, if you disregard this particular position, then you are really obliterating yourself to a very important aspect which you need to be very, very conscious of. So let's talk about a few things. We are all aware, for example, about the Supreme Court judgment in the case of Vodafone. And I'm not onto the Vodafone judgment per se, the merits of the judgment and whatever retrospective amendment happened. But the fact of the matter is that when Vodafone filed a writ petition to the Bombay High Court, and the limited proposition was whether an overseas transfer with an underlying value in India, whether or not it gives rise to taxable income in India, one would have approached maybe a dozen odd councils, and people laughed at the revenue to say, is such an action even sustainable? This is likely to very, very much succeed. And the fact of the matter is that Vodafone lost before the Bombay High Court twice, before the Supreme Court accepted this proposition. And who knows on a different day whether the Supreme Court would have given the same judgment or would have given a very different judgment. And all that point I'm trying to make is that outcome in litigation today is something which is extremely uncertain, number one. Number two, litigation has become extremely, extremely expensive. We are all aware, for example, what does it take actually to engage a senior counsel to get him to stand and the fees that are being charged. And therefore, when you start talking to companies, you start talking to clients on tax structuring, and you start talking about ideas which are, so to say, cute, people come back and say, we would rather have certainty and pay a bit of tax than to get into a structuring which is very, very aggressive, which is likely to take us to a litigation stage, and if possible, we would like to avoid it. The unfortunate part, of course, is that even if you plan on a very, very conservative basis, you are likely to end up in a litigation. But that's a separate situation altogether, because, for example, the entire litigation on transfer pricing, which happened on payment of share capital, was something which was absolutely unwarranted. But that, I would say, is unfortunate approach of the tax department. But otherwise, really, as one is looking at transactions and one is looking at structuring, one axiom which comes in is that if you're trying to do something which is very cute, where you're just trying to play on the wordings of the law and there is no substance, and we'll talk a little bit about substance as we go along, then you are heading for litigation, and litigation is not what one is looking for at all. Second point I would just like to make is about general anti-avoidance regulations. And we are all hearing over the last few weeks as to whether in this budget there will be a proposition that general anti-avoidance regulations, which are otherwise supposed to come into effect from 1st April 2015, will or will not get pushback. We'll see in the next few days. I would like to believe, from my interaction with the senior revenue officials, that is most likely to be pushback. But already one has seen judicial gar. And I thought, you know, as we look at planning and structuring, one judgment which has come very recently, something which I am sure all of you have studied, and by something which we must not lose sight of, is a judgment of the Delhi High Court in the case of Shiv Kumar Gupta. A very, very interesting judgment where, for the first time, the High Court tried to analyze all planning and structuring into four different baskets. So they spoke about tax evasion, which of course is totally sort of illegal, impermissible. They spoke about tax mitigation, which is really just planning and taking advantage of the provisions of law, and which is something which is permitted. And then they came back to say, then there are arrangements, structures which you create, which are permissible and impermissible. And they said what is permissible and what is impermissible will depend on facts of each case, whether in each case there is substance or there is no substance. And obviously that was a gray area with the left in that particular case. It was a favorable judgment. But really, you now have broken up the entire planning scenario into these four buckets: mitigation on one hand, evasion on the other, arrangements in between, and impermissible arrangements and impermissible arrangements. And again, GAR is speaking about those very same things, impermissible tax avoidance agreements. And really, every time, whether or not GAR gets pushed back, one is looking at an arrangement, one will have to come back and say, is this structure, which the courts in the ultimate analysis are likely to regard as a permissible arrangement or not? Let's look at the global scenario. And again, a very, very interesting scenario out there. The debate on tax morality continues as it is, and is likely to continue for quite some time. But look at the situation where a company no less than Apple and the CEO of Apple was summoned by the US Senate to explain how Apple was able to keep away billions of dollars outside of UK, outside of USA, into Ireland and not pay taxes in USA. I'm sure many of you who deal with USA would be aware that one of the fundamental axioms of planning in USA is the ability to defer taxes. So if you have checked your box, if under certain circumstances monies are not brought into USA, then the income is not liable to tax in USA, and people have been able to keep back billions of dollars outside of USA by simply not bringing money into USA. And just about a fortnight back, a proposition has been introduced in the Senate by President Obama. God knows whether it will pass through or not, and how many years it will take before it passes through. But it's just an interesting proposition for us to understand, because this goes to the tenet of tax planning as it is understood in USA. The president has now come back to say in this particular bill, to say that all monies which are kept outside of USA will mandatorily be brought into USA, and whether you bring it or not will be liable to tax in USA at a rate of 14%. So one time lower rate of tax as opposed to 35% rate which currently prevails. You pay taxes on all your overseas income in USA one time at 14%. And then the president came back to say that because this income which is arising year on year is so substantial, I will reduce the rate of tax in USA from 35% to 28%. And on a going forward basis, there is no such thing like check the box. There is no such thing like a blocker. All income arising to US corporations anywhere in the world will be taxed year on year at 19%. I was talking just last week to a couple of practitioners in USA, and some of them made a very startling statement. It may be a bit of a stretch, but it just gave the mood that if at all this bill became law, then tax planning in USA would just come to an end, because that is the basic tenet of tax planning in USA. So again, countries are looking at to say, are we really going to permit in our domestic law structures which are going to permit tax planning, allowing people to keep monies overseas, and is there not a different way of looking at it? We are aware of, for example, how UK has approached the entire structuring aspect. We are all aware about the Starbucks issue. Ordinarily, for example, one would have said that Starbucks is operating in UK. It is operating on a distribution model, meaning thereby that it is importing coffee beans into UK. The coffee beans are brought presumably at an arm's length transfer pricing basis, and the transfer pricing regulations have been complied with. All that is doing in USA is to sell, and because it is just a seller, the profits liable to tax in UK should be a reseller's profit and no more than that. And the amount of taxes which Starbucks ended up paying was so measly that there was a public outcry and a voluntary payment of tax by Starbucks in UK. And we are now looking at what we are calling as a Google tax, coming back to say that just because you are purchasing goods on internet, it cannot be that it will be taxed only in the source country. The country from which purchases are made should have some right to tax income arising from such sales. So again, we are looking at how structures are being pierced through and how people are looking at taxes. And again, as Nitin mentioned earlier, all of this has happened primarily because when there was a recession, the economies of each of the foreign countries were going down. People came back to say, we are unable to collect revenues, and therefore let's look at what are the cute structures which have been set up by people, try and attack those structures and see how we can collect revenues. And irrespective of whether the global economy revives or not, this attempt to say that we are going to collect taxes in that particular country is going to continue all the time. We always said that developing countries like India would like to have a source-based taxation and not a residence-based taxation. That thought is just proliferating. And therefore, again, how you put your structures around that is going to be something which is going to be very, very important on a going forward basis. We will be talking at length about the BEPS initiative, about the fact of base erosion and profit splitting, and what is it that OECD is doing about it, what are the new likely shape of things which are going to come about it, and how it is going to impact the way we looked at structuring of transactions on a going forward basis. So with this sort of background, let's look at some of the things which arise on inbound structuring and what are the new developments there. Every time we look at structuring for inbound investments, I think there are a few things which we start looking at. One is choice of entity, one is use of holding companies. So third is, if we were to make profits, how does that profit get extracted out of the country? Availability of foreign tax credits, so that if you are subjected to double taxation, can you take credits for the taxes paid into your residence country jurisdiction? And finally, if you exited the business, are you able to get your monies free of taxes? So five tenets normally which come about, whether it is inbound structuring, outbound structuring, as something which is very, very critical. And if you go down that path, one issue which comes up is, what is the choice of entity? And I would just like to table this thought to you, nothing radical, nothing different about this thought. But have we all paid adequate attention to use of limited liability partnership as an entity? As we are aware, the concept got introduced about 4 years back. Foreign investment was still not clarified. That got clarified a year and a half back. But you would still find most of the people who operate in this country, and if you are looking at particularly foreign investments into this country, all of them are structured as private limited company, if they are unlisted or listed companies or whatever else. And the question is a structure of a private limited company the appropriate structure, or should one look at limited liability partnership? And if one does look at limited liability partnership as a structure for operations, what are those impediments and how does one migrate to that structure? So let me just briefly take you, without taking into too much of time, we are all aware of the position, that if you are looking at purely from a tax perspective, while the rate of corporate tax is same, whether you are operating as a private limited company or an LLP does not have the disadvantage of a dividend distribution tax, there is no minimum alternate tax, and there is no buyback tax. Whether all of these advantages will remain or will not remain, when the budget comes, only time will show. And maybe we need to have a follow-on discussion on this whole thing after the budget. But clearly, from a pure tax perspective, as it stands today, a significant advantage if you were structured as an LLP as compared to a private limited company. From an FDI perspective, there are a few restrictions which apply to an LLP which do not apply to a private limited company. So for example, if you are operating as an LLP, you need to have a cash infusion. You cannot have an in-kind infusion. You cannot have swap, etc. Whereas if you were to be a private limited company, you could have those, but those probably are not significant disadvantages. But look at from a governance framework. And I think this is very, very critical. Most often when we talk to our clients about structure, we talk only about taxes and really we forget number of other things which apply. Purely from a governance perspective, you would find that the reporting requirements of a private limited company are so significant. The New Companies Act, as we are all aware, imposes so significant restrictions on operations of a company, the liability of directors, the provision for rotation of auditors, and what have you. Whereas if you were to be a limited liability partnership, you have so much less compliance requirements. You don't need to have your board meetings. You don't need to worry about. In fact, you are virtually like a branch. So as you accumulate profits, you can go on sending those profits. So long as you have the profits, the distribution to the partners. And the question is, have we examined for ourselves, when we put structure around inbound investments, whether it is a current, a new flowing investment or an existing investment, use of a limited liability partnership as opposed to a private limited company? And I must confess, as I look around, that very, very few people apply their mind to it, although it appears to be a very, very simple issue. So, as I mentioned, significant advantages, but what are the key considerations? As you look at a venture being a limited liability partnership as opposing to a company, if you want to convert and you want a tax neutrality, then you have to have a turnover which is a very, very low threshold of 60 lakhs of rupees. So if your turnover is more than 60 lakhs of rupees and you convert yourself into an LLP, then it is regarded as a transfer and therefore liable to capital gains tax. And two questions come in. Question number one is, even without this specific provision, under the old case laws, where Part 9 conversions were regarded as not giving rise to a transfer, can one really take a view that per se, a conversion into an LLP is not subject to capital gains tax? And again, one may not want to take that view because of a staring litigation. But would one want to look at a situation where you have an existing private limited company with a track record of 3 years with less than 60 lakhs of turnover, merge an existing company with it, and then could we examine the situation as to whether the legacy of a higher turnover in an existing company which merges into a new co applies to a new co, and is that conversion possible? And again, a lot of opportunities in and around this. As I see going forward, irrespective of the fact of what comes in the budget as to whether or not a distribution tax, for example, is imposed on an LLP, more and more companies will want to convert into LLPs and will want to find innovative ways of how one can make that happen. Let's look at holding companies and use of holding companies for investment into India. And a very, very simple proposition, one would say that a US company, for example, making investment into an Indian company, no controversy one would have thought. And look at the situation out here, that if a US company was holding an Indian company and the shares of the Indian company were sold in the case of an exit and capital gains arose, India would want to tax such capital gains in India on the basis that income is arising in India because the location of the shares is where the registered office of the company is, which is in India. And look at what US says. US goes on a source principle, and USA would regard that such income is actually sourced in USA because the company which is sourcing the income is holding the shares in USA. And we actually have practical cases where US companies have been subjected to a double tax and not been granted credit for taxes which are paid in India on capital gains, only on account of the fact that US regards this as a US source income and India regards this as an Indian source income. And therefore, you know, when somebody was euphemistically saying that you use Mauritius for making investment into India, not because you want double non-taxation, but because you want to avoid a double taxation in India and USA on capital gains, because you are not examined at the first threshold level whether this income would be regarded as Indian source by India and US source by USA, and therefore not granting credit for taxes which are paid in India. Moving on from there, we are all familiar with this structure, nothing big to talk about interposing an intermediary company. And the question is, how long will this boilerplate things that we have been doing, which is to interpose either a Singapore company or a Mauritius company, continue? Is this something which is going to fall flat at some point of time or the other? So if GAAR comes into play with effect from 1st April 2015, certainly we are going to see how Mauritius India tax treaty will come under a strain. But as I said, maybe GAAR might be pushed back, as is most likely to be the case. All of us are wishing with fingers crossed that GAAR does get pushed back. But even assuming there is no GAAR, is this something which is likely to stand the test of time all the time? Is the judgment of the Supreme Court in Azadi Bachao Andolan something which is likely to continue to hold sway? Is it very, very likely, for example, that the India-Mauritius treaty is itself going to undergo a change and a limitation of benefit clause inserted? And when we talk about BEPS, I'm going to deal with this a little bit at length, as to how is India approaching the limitation of benefit versus how OECD is looking at limitation of benefit. India has approached limitation of benefit, for example, under the Singapore treaty, to say that you will be granted a benefit of India-Singapore tax treaty provided your expenditure threshold of $200,000 is met and provided to the subjective satisfaction of the Indian tax officer you are not structuring yourself in Singapore only for the purpose of availing capital gains tax exemption. A huge amount of subjectivity. You are walking into a litigation framework with an Indian tax office. Whereas OECD would like to first come back and say that any limitation of benefit has to be objective, the way it is, for example, under the Netherlands-USA tax treaty, where a whole three page of the tax treaty really provides criteria as to who is the real beneficial owner of the investment. And if that beneficial owner ultimately is not a resident of that country from where the investment is made, treaty benefits have sought to be denied. And the question is, will India also move towards that regime? Is the regime of what India-Singapore provides a right regime, or are we going to see a different regime? How will limitation of benefit apply when India-Mauritius treaty, for example, is renegotiated? A question again often comes up that is one better off structuring oneself in Singapore compared to Mauritius? A question which actually comes in almost every single day, to say that if you are structured in Singapore, maybe you are better off because there is a limitation of benefit. And under the Shom Committee report, which is not yet been accepted in the context of Section 9 and also in the context of GAAR, that once there is a limitation of benefit under the treaty, then domestic general anti-avoidance regulations will not apply. Is that going to be the position going forward? Are we better off there? And again, we are aware in the recent past how people have sort of migrated their investments, or how new funds, for example, have been set up in Singapore as opposed to being set up in Mauritius. Again, a discussion and a debate which is warranted every time one is making an investment. But one thing which probably we should not lose sight of is that, are we advising our clients to create more and more substance? In effect, if you are using an intermediary holding company at any point of time, you are unlikely to be doing everything that is necessary. But are we creating substance which is sufficient for a holding company perspective? And if we are not, then we are really living in hopes that just because there is an Azadi Bachao Andolan, just because there is a circular 789, we are kosher and we don't need to worry about inapplicability of the TT. This is something which I would believe is something we need to look at all the time. And I think the more the substance we can create, the better we are. The physical board meetings, we are aware, for example, that Mauritius has itself changed its tax residence certificate regulations and imposed some more conditions now in Mauritius which need to be complied with. And that's a very, very, very welcome step. But are we really able to advise our clients how to create more and more structure, more and more substance in a jurisdiction if you are using an intermediate holding company is going to be key as we move forward. Let's look at yet another structure which comes up all the time. That can you structure investments into India using a dual investment company? So in a typical situation, you have India and then you have Mauritius above it, and you have yet another Mauritius company above it, and then the country from which the investment is flowing. Let's take USA in this particular example. And the proposition which comes up is that if you want to sell India, are you better off if Holdco 2 was to sell shares of the Indian company, and if you don't want to test the treaty, is it really a better thing to do if Holdco 1 was to sell Holdco 2? We are all aware, for example, about the amendment to Section 9 and the extreme uncertainty surrounding that. We still don't have what is the definition of the word substantial assets in India under Section 9. We have a Delhi High Court judgment which speaks about more than 50%. Is that judgment which is something which is going to be accepted by the tax office? Are we going to see some clarity in this budget? We do not know. Hopefully we will. But until then, really, how do we advise our clients on what sort of is an appropriate structure? Is, for example, an issue if, for example, you structure this way, a payment of dividend by Holdco 1 back to a foreign company, a subject matter of separate dividend distribution tax? Because under the definition of an Indian company given in Section 9, a foreign company which has got substantial assets in India is a company which is liable to be regarded as an Indian company. And if you are an Indian company, the dividends flowing all the way up could be liable to multiple dividend distribution tax. Is there something which we can do in and around that? And then the final question, that is our assumption that if Holdco 1 was to sell the shares of Holdco 2, then because Holdco 1 is also a resident of Mauritius, the tax treaty will apply, a right assumption? Or would it really be that because Holdco 1 is assumed to be an Indian company, it will not be eligible to the tax treaty benefits between India and Mauritius, notwithstanding the fact that it's holding a tax residence certificate? Again, questions to which I don't think there are any definitive answers, but what sort of structures we put in and around that is going to be something which is very, very critical. I think cash extraction is becoming increasingly a very, very important thing. You know, we all speak about Make in India, we all speak about Vibrant Gujarat, and I think I must just share this experience with you. I was at Vibrant Gujarat Forum, and there's so many people talking about how India is the place to be in. There were global CEOs eulogizing how sort of the mid-market in India provides enough and more opportunities, how the new prime minister is making India a very, very attractive destination once again to do business in. And then as a smaller forum gathered under the aegis of USIBC, I was hearing a US CEO of a very, very large Fortune 50 company talk about his operations in India. And he started to say that at one level, yes, I want to be in India because it's a huge market. It offers cost advantage for my global operations. But let me tell you, what do I have in India? I have 13 manufacturing plants and 7 R&D centers in India, all sort of structured as separate independent entities. I have got huge amount of cash which I generate in this country. But if I pay that cash out, I'm subjected to a dividend distribution tax of 20%. That makes me terribly unattractive from a tax perspective, and therefore I have retained my cash here. And then I was just in the process of making a $180 million acquisition in India, and what I am told is that I can't use my existing cash because I can't move cash between companies. There are issues with regard to 222E, etc., etc. And therefore, notwithstanding the fact that I had cash in this country, I was forced to bring remittance from overseas for my acquisition. So we now have dividend distribution tax, we have a buyback tax. Are there really opportunities out there on structuring which can help us mitigate both of them? One has, for example, looked at the possibility of recapitalizing an Indian company. So you have an Indian company today, let's assume its capital is just about $10 million, it's become very, very profitable, it's operating on a cost-plus basis, huge reserves, huge turnover. Is it possible to recapitalize that company to its current market value? And thereafter, if there was a buyback tax, it could only be on the value which is incremental beyond the recapitalized value. Is there restructuring possible, particularly before GAAR kicks in? And again, something which you need to consider. But if we are unable to get cash out in a very appropriate manner, we have a challenge. And then obviously, one is looking at debt pushdown. I earlier spoke to you about LLP. And while LLP seems to be a very, very attractive structure, we need to realize that there are restrictions, for example, on external commercial borrowing by an LLP or investment in down below subsidiaries by an LLP. And assuming all of that was required, is there a way we can use the current structure into a company by introducing debt? And how is it that one can, because we still do not have thin capitalization rules? When GAAR kicks in, and if GAAR was to kick in, there is an apprehension that some of those thin capitalization rules will come in as it is. But until we have thin capitalization rules, is it possible to have a huge debt out here? Can one use, for example, listed NCDs as a means of introducing debt? And is that something which can provide us a tax shelter? So while we have probably a 5 or a 10% tax on interest, do we get a tax shelter? How is it that one uses royalty as a means of extracting cash from out of India? Again, issues which we need to factor as we put structures together. And again, the reason I'm not venturing to give answers to each one, because there are no boilerplate answers. Each situation requires a different examination, but probably sometimes we lose sight of the fact that as we put a structure together for inbound investment, there are a number of things that we can do, which earlier maybe we did not consider, but today we do need to consider. Again, we spoke about royalties. The ability today to take royalties out without any restriction under FEMA, but subject to transfer pricing, is there something which we can weave out there? Or for example, while we are speaking about structuring of the investment, purely from an investment perspective, are we considering how should we structure the Indian company from operations perspective? And let me just elaborate what I mean. Is it that all manufacturing companies in India have to be entrepreneurs? Can a manufacturing company in India be, for example, a subcontractor? And is it possible that my IPRs are residing overseas and therefore the profits that I make in India are de minimis? Can I get an APA in and around that? Is that something which we normally consider as we put a structure together? And going forward, this aspect of transfer pricing as to how do I structure Indian operation is going to be something which is very, very critical. We have typically seen only in the context of service companies, BPOs, etc., where India operates on a cost-plus basis, and we say that an Indian company is a mere service provider, not an entrepreneur. Is it possible to do so even in a manufacturing company? What happens in a manufacturing company if an Indian company was to be a subcontractor? Can there be domestic sales? If so, who will make those domestic sales? Is it possible, for example, to evolve tripartite agreements where you have two Indian companies, one which is a subcontractor, other which is a distributor, both operating a sort of at a de minimis margins with a foreign company undertaking all the risk? Again, something which we need to factor in all the time. So one is structuring from an investment side, other is structuring from an operating side. And again, do we need to consider all the time, as I mentioned, that because we now have an APA regime, can we go to the Advance Pricing Authority, get a ruling around many of these, and sort of have a certainty around what we need to do and not be subjected to ongoing prolonged litigation? I mentioned to you about the need for getting credit for taxes paid in India in an overseas jurisdiction. We earlier spoke, for example, in the context of cash extraction, about dividend distribution tax. And we have this controversy ongoing that because today dividend distribution tax is a tax which is paid by the Indian company, is the foreign company entitled to take credit for it in the overseas jurisdiction when the dividend is received? And if the dividend is itself a subject matter of taxation in the country of receipt, and I do not get credit for the taxes paid in India by way of dividend distribution taxes because they are not creditable, am I ending up with paying dual taxes? What happens to a buyback tax? Again, we have a situation in the context of a buyback tax that the tax is paid by the Indian company. If the tax is paid by the Indian company, then do I get a credit overseas? And if I don't get a credit overseas, what happens? Of course, one of the very important suggestions which has been given for this budget, and one is hoping, again with fingers crossed, that the finance minister accepts it, is that a provision be inserted in the Income Tax Act to say that dividend distribution tax, although payable by the Indian company, will be a tax deemed to be paid for and on behalf of the foreign company, so that credit is available for that in the country of residence. But again, whether that gets accepted, does not get accepted is a matter. But are we really putting structures such that we are able to take that back? Are we able to put an intermediary holding company such that those credits can be taken and flown through all the way back? Those are the things which we need to consider. Finally, we are aware of MAT and the issue on MAT, which is as to whether if you do not have a presence in India and you are making investments from overseas and therefore you are not required to maintain books of accounts in India, are you required to pay minimum alternate tax? And the reason I mentioned this particular issue in the context of tax structuring is that really there was a clarification which came in the last budget, more by way of a statement from the finance minister, that a presence in India of an advisory company, a management company, will not be regarded as giving rise to permanent establishment in India. Is that something which one can use to ensure that one is not liable to pay MAT tax? An issue often arises, for example, and this is a very interesting thing, that if an Indian company is holding shares of a listed entity, when those shares are sold on the stock exchange and securities transaction tax is paid, there is no capital gains tax. But again, there is MAT. Are we really looking at structures which one can use to eliminate or avoid that MAT? So as an example, for example, could you have a situation where an Indian company which has got shares of a listed company merge into another company, you do purchase price accounting in the context of a merger and therefore recognize the shares in the new entity at a market value, at the current value, and therefore when you sell, your book value has gone up and therefore there are no book profits? Are there structures in and around that? Again, I say there are no boilerplate answers, but again, number of things which one can think about, again factoring all the time that are you having substance to do whatever you are doing? It is not something which you are doing only for the purpose of taxes, things which we need to consider. Let's talk about outbound structuring. And while I was asked to deal with outbound structuring, I don't think there are too many current developments on outbound structuring, but really let's just look at what are the factors which you would consider in the context of outbound structuring. So generally, we are all aware today that under automatic route for an outbound structure, outbound investment, there are not too many restrictions at all. FEMA sort of liberally permits you to make those investments. I don't need to get into each one of those conditions which are out here. There are additional conditions to be fulfilled if that investment is made by an Indian company which is engaged in financial services or you are engaged in real estate, etc., etc. We spoke about the key considerations in the context of inbound investment. What are the key considerations which one would look when you structure outbound investment? One is, of course, the need for using SPVs, whether there are holding company regimes, which are very critical, which are very, very important. Are there participation exemptions, and I'll talk a little bit as we go ahead, or thin cap rules which we need to consider? Again, this is all from an investment perspective, but from an operating perspective, are there IPR regimes which one can look at where one is able to house IPRs overseas and sort of able to park those valuable assets overseas, so in the context of a disposition, one is not liable to tax? And finally, what are the withholding tax provisions? Quickly, let's look at use of SPVs and some of the benefits which arise in the context of SPVs. Clearly, every time you want to make an investment overseas and you use an SPV, some of the key benefits which you look at is the flexibility in borrowing. So, if you took a debt in India for the purpose of making an acquisition overseas, Are you able to borrow in foreign currency? Are you able to hedge that currency for a limited period of time? Whereas if you were to use a holding company, an intermediary holding company in between, are you able to get far better terms overseas? Are you able to hedge over a longer period of time? Is your leveraging capacity better or not? The ability to get a JV partner overseas for an overseas investment as opposed to making such an investment through India. What are the bilateral agreements that exist? What are the TT networks that exist? The tax efficiency, again, the ease of exit, the possibility of overseas listing, which is becoming more and more important today. And one of the things which I have not spoken about at length here, but which is a subject in itself, is when you have outbound investments from India, what is the right structure? Is the structure that India holds overseas or overseas holds India? In a manner that one is able to do an IPO either which way, which is the right structure? How does one flip structures and what are the issues in and around flip structures? And finally, ring fencing of risk, because a direct investment poses certain amount of risk and intermediary holding company provides a particular insulation of risk. Let's look at a few things which you would consider, and I repeat that while I have been asked to deal with this subject, I don't see too many new considerations or new developments which are happening in and around here. But one is participation exemption. And I think that becomes very, very important when one is looking at an intermediary holding company. Are you really able to say that the jurisdiction which I have, from which I make onward investments, granting me participation exemption, such that all the taxes that I have paid overseas are either creditable or are not required to be taxed at all in that jurisdiction? Netherlands, as we are all aware, is one such jurisdiction which provides for participation exemption. And again, there are a number of conditions which one needs to comply with when one is looking at a participation exemption. Are those conditions something which one can easily fulfill? In the context of IPR regime, and I mentioned that if you have IPR and IPR can be relocated, can one look at exit tax in India? As you know, if you have an IPR currently sitting in India and you want India to not be an entrepreneur, but just be a risk-free service provider, one can migrate IPR from India into another jurisdiction. Can one evaluate what is the exit cost of getting IPR out of the country? What is the cost of incremental IPRs which will happen? How will Indian company then be evolved in the development of the IPR? And can one use jurisdictions like for UK, which has very, very recently introduced the patent box regime, where one is able to develop IPR, and if thereafter the IPR is sold, the tax consequences in UK are de minimis. Again, is a lot of structuring possibility in and around that. Withholding tax exemptions in respect of dividends, royalties, again become very, very critical. In the recent past, there are two jurisdictions which have attempted to be favorable holding company jurisdiction, Singapore and UK. I was quite amused. I was talking to some of the top lawyers in UK as to how UK has evolved as a holding company jurisdiction. And what happened was that about 4 years back, one of the largest companies operating from out of UK, which is WPP, which is the company, the largest advertising agency in the world, owned by Martin Sorrell, decided to move out of UK because it found the holding company jurisdiction in UK to be not favorable. And unlike India, they were quick to react to say, what is more important to us? Is the tax which we will collect in UK more important, or is it more important for us to have business in UK? And they came to a conclusion that was obviously business which was more important because of the employment and everything that it generated. And it came back to with a new jurisdiction guideline, which is very, very attractive, where again, one can sort of look at almost a zero tax in respect of any income which is repatriated into UK and use the favorable treaty network which UK has got everywhere. Needless to mention, WPP relocated to UK, and now UK has become a very, very favorable destination for holding companies. Or take Singapore, where one can actually go out and negotiate a lower rate of tax for operations in Singapore and use of Singapore for outbound investments, where one can actually sit with the authorities in Singapore and go back and say, your normal rate of tax is 17%. These are the operations which we would like to carry out in Singapore, as a result of which we believe that the Singapore economy is so much favorably supported, and therefore we want a lower rate of tax. And one has seen taxes being renegotiated generally at 5%, but in some cases even at 0%, because Singapore would like to believe that that 0% tax and the tax foregone is far more compensated by whatever happens as a growth of the economy. So again, can one consider many of those? And then finally, how does one get the money back into the country? Let's move on quickly to BEPS. We've got, what, 15 minutes more? So BEPS was basically a recognition. Lots of time, not okay. Thank you. So as we look at OECD, and OECD started to look at to say that we evolved tax treaties. The tax treaties were evolved over a period of time, and the context which came up was that the tax treaties which were evolved over a period of time, were they relevant or did they need a relook? And the entire international tax regime, as we have seen over a period of time, does it need a relook in the light of the emerging economies? Number of situations, digital economy, the issue of hybrid entities, and we'll come to each one of them as we go on. And BEPS committed, constituted a committee to look at many of those. The first action plan which was released was in July 2013. And as was stated in that, and I'll just read out that particular thing, the purpose of the action plan, as was stated in the OECD report, is to prevent double non-taxation as well as cases of no or low taxation associated with practices that artificially segregate taxable income from activities that generate it. So a very simple proposition. Not paying tax is not an issue. Low taxation is not an issue. But are you really segregating income from the activities that generate the income? So for example, are you artificially moving risk into a particular jurisdiction, which really is not a risk-free jurisdiction because the activities are located somewhere else? And therefore, OECD came back to say that the only way in which on a consistent basis you can ensure that country's tax base is not eroded and profits are not taken out is to ensure that activities and income are married to each other. The action plan which OECD came out with covers 15 specific actions which have been promised to be implemented over a two-year period. That two-year period ends in September 2015. As things look like, it's very unlikely that all those action plans will get implemented. But it gives a thinking of how the world is re-looking at this issue of base erosion and profit split. What are the key areas which BEPS is looking at? The key areas which BEPS is looking at first is transfer pricing. And I think this is going to be the single largest area of focus so far as BEPS is concerned. How are the agreements between associated enterprises structured on a going forward basis? That profits arise in a jurisdiction where action is taking place, where substance actually resides. So are you really artificially, as I said, moving people functions? Are you relocating IPRs? We spoke about IPR regime in the context of outbound investments. But are you really relocating IPRs at a jurisdiction merely because there is a ability to get a lower rate of tax there? Or is there really substance in whatever you are doing there? The other issue on which OECD spent a lot of time was on hybrids. Entities which are classified differently in different jurisdictions. Transactions which are classified differently in different jurisdictions. You are regarded as a partnership in jurisdiction one, in other jurisdiction, the same entity is regarded as corporate. And how do you use hybrids to mitigate tax? And is there a way to ensure that entities are regarded in a like manner in different jurisdictions? Interest deduction. And again, the issue here was, can we have some uniformity of approach to thin capitalization? Can we ensure that profits from a particular jurisdiction are not taken out merely because there is an interest charge which is paid to an associated enterprise, which is really an artificial debt and is not a debt of the enterprise at all. Treaty abuse. It's very interesting that as OECD was looking at treaty abuse, the one treaty which caught their attention and which actually was mentioned in the report is the India-Mauritius tax treaty. And they came back to say that, are we really using India-Mauritius tax treaty in a manner which is abusive to India? And I was reflecting that really one did not need OECD and BEPS to really prevent abuse of India-Mauritius tax treaty. It is more a context of how India is looking at it. If India wanted to, it can go ahead and really abrogate the treaty. It can do domestic things on the treaty and do whatever else to ensure that the treaty is not abused. So if it is rather than treaty being abused, it is India wanting the treaty to get abused because it believes that investments are something which you need, and Mauritius is a conduit for that investment. How long will that continue? I do not know. But BEPS is looking to say, can we put a framework where countries like India cannot permit use of Mauritius for luring investments into the country? Digital economy. Very interesting, and again we'll talk a little bit later as we go along on BEPS. This was one matter which engaged OECD's attention, that in the context of digital economy is the concept of permanent establishment, which we look at this point of time, really a need to relook at that entire concept. Is really a fixed place of business really a mandatory thing for the purpose of permanent establishment? Is some other criteria which should come over? And this is one action plan on which OECD actually came out with sort of a paper. And the unfortunate part is that that paper said nothing. All that it said is there is a need to relook, and in the different actions that we take and in different other action plans, we'll try to see how to weave in the digital economy into that. Just shows how difficult is this subject to deal with and how difficult it is to get consensus. But again, we need to be alive to the fact that OECD is closely examining the digital economy issues. What is it that BEPS is proposing to do? So first is to say, change the model tax convention, again in context of hybrids we spoke about, treaty abuse, etc. More important, recommend changes in the domestic law. So one of the things which came about was the recognition of the fact that if you allow abuse of treaty and thereby tax is evaded, then you will sort of make your domestic law very strong because you want to collect more and more taxes. We are all aware, for example, that because the tax officers in India have targets to collect, they will try and create artificial income. That would not have arisen if we are able to expand our tax base in an appropriate manner. So BEPS recognizes this position and says that how do you have domestic law which does not become needlessly aggressive because all income that is supposed to be taxed in a particular jurisdiction is indeed taxed. But the concept is that even if OECD recommends that this is what should be the model tax law, domestic tax law, can it enforce such a model tax law on each of its members? The answer is obviously no, but OECD is looking at trying to put pressure, a peer pressure, to say this is what we believe the domestic law should be modeled. So can we have, for example, an ideal uniform tax law all over the world, which of course is utopia, but that's the path which we are going to. And finally, changes in the transfer pricing guidelines, I spoke about this earlier, to ensure that the transfer pricing outcomes are in line with value creation. Transfer pricing happens where value is actually created, not where you are residing some functions merely because they are convenient from a tax perspective. This is an overview. So the OECD came back to say that all the steps that it is talking, the 15 action points, can be broken up into three broad categories. The first category is coherence, ensuring that things are uniform. And it put four action items there, which was on the hybrid mismatch, the CFC regulations, the interest deduction, the harmful tax practice. We are all again aware of the earlier efforts that were made to sort of blacklist countries by saying that these are the countries which are engaging in harmful tax practice. That is intended to be carried forward and taken to a logical conclusion. So these are the four action plans on coherence. There are five action plans on substance, which is to ensure that every action that is taken, there is substance, and therefore the issues which come up there are on preventing treaty abuse, avoidance of permanent establishment status. Very interesting. So OECD has come back to say that more often than not, You try and take advantage of exclusions to permanent establishment and misuse the treaty. So for example, if a treaty provides that certain actions are preparatory and auxiliary in nature, you would want to structure your operations in a manner that all the activities that you carry out are regarded as preparatory and auxiliary. And it observed that certain companies behave in a manner that in a particular country, they will have two separate entities, one which is carrying on activities which are only preparatory and auxiliary, and other which are supposed to carry on other activities. How do you prevent abuse of that? Are you using multiple jurisdictions to carry on preparatory and auxiliary activities such that overall, if all of that was aggregated together, it would not really be preparatory and auxiliary activities, but would be actual business activities? And how does one prevent that abuse of exemptions? How do you transfer price the aspects of intangibles? Something that is very, very dear to India. We are all aware, for example, of the litigation which Microsoft faced in India on the basis that it was developing intangibles in India, although it was merely an outsourcing agent. Again, are there tax implications in and around that? How does one deal with that entire thing? Transfer pricing of risk and capital, and finally, transfer pricing of high-risk transactions. These are the five items which fall under the bucket of substance. And then four items on transparency, methodologies and data analysis, disclosure rules. And this is again going to be something which we need to be very much alive to. One of the things which BEPS is talking about is a country by country reporting. So in India, for example, we have always insisted on transfer pricing being done for India. Not every country insist on that. In most of the countries, you can have a global transfer pricing documentation which is valid. And what BEPS is insisting is two things. First, have a country by country reporting, and have that country by country reporting available to all the countries where an MNC operates. So if a tax officer in India is seeking to tax the profits of an MNC in India, he would now have the report, country by country report available of an MNC all over the world in a manner that he can know exactly where profits are being parked and therefore come to an analysis as to whether India is getting a fair share or not. And more important, the disclosure requirements also mean that any information which is asked for is available automatically, and in most cases, information is shared between countries even without having to be asked for. So you don't take advantage of exchange of information, confidentiality requirements, domestic law, secrecy, and all of that, but all information is shared in a particular manner. So as we go ahead, we just need to be aware that any structure that we put together, the visibility of that structure is complete to a tax official in every country. So more particularly, we are talking of India. An Indian tax officer has an insight into everything that an MNC is doing in every jurisdiction and can therefore reach a logical conclusion as to whether or not the profits which are subjected to tax in India are appropriate or not. Dispute resolution. And here, what has been recommended, and which of course has been a subject matter of debate for the last several years, but the debate has gone nowhere, is that if under competent authority resolution, two countries are unable to agree, two countries disagree to agree on a particular provision, then one refers to international arbitration. A very, very needed item for dispute resolution so that one does not get stuck on when is aware, for example, under the India-US tax treaty, where matters are pending, going on, being discussed between the two competent authorities who always meet and are never able to reach a conclusion. In a situation like that, within a specified time frame of, say, 2 years, if the authorities cannot come to a conclusion, then the matter gets referred to international arbitration and the award of the arbitrator will be binding on both the countries. Again, whether this ultimately gets into model conventions, whether each of the countries accept or not, remains to be seen. But as you can see, a sweeping range of recommendations, sort of totally changing the way we have been approaching taxes and structuring in the past on how it will be in future. So you are relying on now to say everything is transparent. Unless there is substance, you cannot do anything at all. Your profits will follow substance. Your profits will not follow form at all. There is a complete visibility of whatever you are doing to the tax authorities around the world, and you cannot park your profits in a country where there is just which indulges in harmful tax practice. Let's wait to see whether in our lifetime all of this gets implemented, and if it does, whether tax practice as we understand will at all survive or will truly become a compliance practice. But interesting time, something which you need to be alive to, something which cannot lose sight of. Spoken about most of this. We spoke about harmful tax practice and the substance part. And in the interim report, which has been titled as Countering Harmful Tax Practices More Effectively, OECD has come back to say that a substantial activity is a factor which determines a regime as which encourages purely tax-driven operations or arrangements. So it says that if a particular regime permits a particular set of activities to take place in that regime merely because it is tax driven, that will be regarded as a harmful tax practice, and therefore that regime consequently would be sort of blacklisted and therefore not eligible for treaty benefits and whatever else. So again, form a sort of acute emphasis on substance all the way. Again, regimes which meet the no or low tax effective rates will be considered as harmful, and therefore again blacklisted, not eligible to TT benefits. So substance is going to become the key as we go forward. Where does this place India? We have long had this debate, and in fact Nitin, when he began the discussions today, spoke about Westminster, McDowell, Vodafone, and there has been this consistent debate as to a two-bench Supreme Court judgment versus a three-bench judgment, what really prevails, and really what is the last word on tax planning. And we continue to keep on arguing whether the Vodafone judgment of the Supreme Court really has put back to say that McDowell's is not really a good law. One can do planning, etc., etc. I spoke to you earlier about the decision of the Delhi High Court in the case of Gupta. But if we were to implement BEPS, probably all of this would be history. One would go back and say a form of transaction is not relevant at all. What is relevant is nothing but substance, and to go through that substance, an officer has all the information that he needs available to him, and he will make his assessment on that basis. So what are the key takeaways? First is, BEPS is going to be a game changer in the coming years. It remains to be seen how the countries who are members of OECD, and India is not a member of OECD, although it is actively partaking in the BEPS exercise, how will countries adopt it? How will model tax conventions undergo a change? For example, there is one proposition to say you do not need bilateral tax agreements at all. You have multilateral tax agreements. So if OECD had its way under BEPS, India would have just one tax treaty with all the 85 countries participating in it and saying this is the way in which taxation of income will happen in all the contracting states. Is that something which is practicable, not practicable? It needs to be seen. How will countries adopt their domestic laws to the recommendations of BEPS? Will countries really give up tax competitiveness is something which remains to be seen, but again something which we need to focus on all the time. Domestic anti-abuse legislation will come into various jurisdictions. India will eventually implement GAR. Even if GAR gets pushed back for a couple of years, it's just a matter of time before India comes back to say we are not a tin pot economy, we need investments, but we do not need the shelter of Mauritius for investments to come into this country. We are not going to permit blatant treaty shopping, and therefore domestic anti-abuse regulations will come to India, will come all over the world, and we need to factor them as we do any structuring. Transparency and exchange of information are not only here to stay, but are going to be increasing. We need to presume that any information which is available in any jurisdiction, we are aware, for example, of how what is happening on HSBC at this point of time. We need to presume that any structure that you create overseas, there is no such thing like creating a trust in Liechtenstein and something lying with by way of a letter of wishes not being available to a tax officer in a particular jurisdiction. We need to be aware that the global tax regime is changing fast. What was regarded as an aggressive tax mechanism by India thus far is something which most of the world countries are willing to now adopt, only because their own tax base is eroding, and therefore one needs to look at that. Whatever structures you create, we need to look at longevity of that structure, not something which is short term, which is trying to take advantage of the current situation. And finally, over the years, the debate on tax morality will continue, and we'll need to sort of have rounds of discussions to say when we all studied law, our accountancy, we were told that either there is tax or either the law provides for taxation or there is no room for equity in taxation. I think that those days are going to be buried and the tax and moral debate will continue. Thank you all so much for a very patient hearing. I'm told you all.
Friends, you've been patient, so just wait for 10-15 more minutes. It's not going to take too much of time. I think we owe to the faculty that we wait till the very end.
So you have spoken about tax.
Can you please tell?
Yeah. You have spoken about tax neutrality in case of conversion of a company into an LLP. So you said that we could have to overcome the condition of 60 lakhs, right? So I just had one point that would it be also possible by means of a demerger? So that
will
also be considered as a new entity.
Yes, indeed, it would be a merger or a demerger. Both can come in. As to whether one should go with a merger or a demerger would depend on facts of each case. But I think the more important point is really, is the entity which you want to convert into an LLP, an entity which has a 3-year track record of less than 60 lakhs turnover. That is the city.
This is more a philosophical question. See, on the one hand, we require huge foreign industry. And most of the Indian corporate business groups, companies are highly leveraged. They are trying to deleverage. On the other hand, there is a huge requirement of funds in all the spheres. So we have to make India an attractive investment destination. So what kind of tax policy in the entire framework do you recommend? Which is fair both to the foreign investor as well as it generates revenue so that the government can fulfill the aspirations of the market. Because even in the last 8-9 months, I am getting a feeling that perhaps the government is working only for capitalists. There is a mention about the poor people. And our electoral politics is such that if they don't do it, they don't have time for waiting for 10, 15, 20 years to wait for the shed in. They want it now.
As I see, that people who are impatient to leave, and I don't want to speak for another 45 minutes which I am going to answer that question. But let me just put it to you. I think most times people do not need tax incentives. People don't need a very low tax rate. All that people are looking for is certainty. Where India is failing is to provide a certain tax regime. So you have a situation where somebody is granted a tax holiday for 5 years or a 10-year tax holiday. In the 6th year, the officer takes a different view on the same activity and says you are not eligible for a tax holiday. And your entire 5 years assessments are reopened. So you have a situation where there is no certainty. There is this whole provision which got introduced for domestic AR, but does not know when will it actually get implemented, when will it constitute wages. And when it really be an AR, those who have a 4-year waiting to get an answer. But to attract foreign investment, you've got to be a jurisdiction which provides opportunities, not a jurisdiction which gives tax incentives. Actually, to my mind, you don't need Mauritius at all to create investments, unless you're looking at FII investment as opposed to an FDI investment, which is a different thing altogether. And as we all know, FII investments are transitionary investments, they are not very long-term investments. But where we are failing singularly is to say this is a stable tax regime and there is a trust factor which people can have to say you will, what your answer you get is the answer which will be implemented in times to come.
My question is related to digital economy. I mean, if supposing there is an Indian company which is into website development or like running a website, and all of my revenues are being generated from Indian corporates or Indian clients. But my site's visibility will be in foreign countries as well. So will there be any possibility that my revenues, which are generated in India, will be taxed in foreign countries just because of my users are in outside, out of India?
So again, two parts to your question. What is the current position and what is likely to be the position? Second thing is something which is well paid for what OECD says. But just go back to the Facebook example. Facebook today, outside of USA, has the largest number of users in India. And the question is, therefore, the valuation of Facebook, whereas it's based on the users, and the users are situated here. Is there, therefore, a way that it could be taxed in India? And the current tax regime, the answer is no. We wait to see what the research will say on this.
Is there any existing regulations in any of the countries outside which is taxing enterprises abroad based on user base or something like that?
The answer is today, probably to the best of my knowledge, I can't profess knowledge of all countries to the best of my knowledge. I am not aware of any country which taxes. But there is actually a discussion going on in the UK to impose what they call as a Google tax, which is to say, can I tax on the basis of user? But that doesn't appear to be anything at this point.
Thank you.
My question may not be directly concerned with today's lecture.
May I request you to stand up,
please? Mr. Shankar?
Yeah.
My question may not directly relate to today's subject. About the international and foreign investment, but the domestic transfer pricing, which has been introduced from last year and covering the portfolio of the expenditure covered by section 48.2 and especially the expenditure pertaining to the service, especially remuneration, director's remuneration as they. Now, can you throw light under which yardstick of this? Which of the five types of costing, a costing will apply to the remuneration paid to a director, as it will cover. So will it lead the corruption which is already rampant? Or see, suppose I have to say that my outside price of director remuneration is what he may get from an outside employer, or suppose what he will pay to an outside employee.
So, I'm introducing this, though, actually, 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 I'm introducing this, though, actually,
thank you, friends. I think you've been a wonderful audience. I now request for you to propose a very well-deserved vote of thanks, and I expect you to have patience for a few more minutes.
Some announcement first, friends. We have a lecture meeting on performance evaluation of board of directors, including independence director. This lecture meeting is going to be held in Babubhai Chennai Hall next Wednesday, that is 25th February, and speaker is Smita Anand. So far as union budget is concerned, among various lecture meetings organized by BCAS, some of the important lecture meetings are on direct tax provision of the finance bill. Lecture meeting will be at the Yogi Sabhagraha on 4th March, Wednesday. This will be, the speaker will be Mr. Soli Dastur. On indirect tax provisions of the finance bill, it will be on 11th March, Wednesday, at same venue, Walchand Hirachand Hall. Speaker will be Mr. Vikram Nankani. Friends, coming to this pleasant task, President sir, Vice President and the seniors, Dinesh bhai, as usual in very lucid terms, has explained the subject matter of today, and you all know that when we have to speak about the recent developments, what is required is experience and exposure. And we have had abundance of experience, exposures, and being shared here by the speaker of today. And that was also meshed with the practical example, which I'm sure will be helpful to all of us. I, on behalf of the Bombay Chartered Accountant Society, and on behalf of all of us present here, propose a very well-deserved vote of thanks to Dinesh Bhai. Thank you.
Yes, yes.